action.
Right, okay, now we are day four. In 4 days, this is what we've taken it up to. If you remember, all this was all blue-grey. And, well, we got the reservoir in. And this, all that lace work that you sort of saw me doing, you know how I do my water? Well, that has now become all this, and it's now been high-lit. I've put a sheen of a moonbeam coming down on that. There's the exploding water from where the bomb has skipped and jumped. I've the bomb yet to put in, which will be leaping from about there. And we have a Lancaster. This is Mick Martin's Lancaster. And following a visit to the Battle of Britain Memorial flight, to watching them doing a practice display a couple of days ago. This is an impression of a Lancaster that's actually from watching them fly. So although it looks nice, there's very little detail in this. It's just a thing made up of lights and glints and backlights and engine fumes and the glint of the moon on the back of the spine there. That actually is where the light on a Lanc's body actually is caught. I actually saw that when I was at Coningsby. And I've got the gun turret, front forward turret firing, and the lights from his height indicator lamps. So that gives me the atmosphere, you see, and also I've added in all this sort of like scud of cloud and this scud here. So all that, as you see, like I said before, it's all the foundations of a house. And then it's slowly and onwardly built up in piece by piece and detail by detail till we get to this stage. Now here, there's going to be a lot more of these explosions in the water where shells are hitting ahead and below and everything like that. And flak coming off the dam walls, and so there'll be bursts and things that they're coming into. And this is the shot that's hitting the reservoir. And then there's just this one and this one to do, which is that's Gibson's Lancaster. This would probably be Dingy Young's Lake, because they certainly were flanking each other like this. But as you see now the way that you do this moonlit sky, let's clear one thing up for that. Remember what I told you about how in reality it should be an inky black and you won't see anything, da da da, recall that, right? Well, what we now have you've got to think of paintings in terms of like musical forms. And if this was a musical piece, it'd be a nocturne before we put all the bombers and all the destruction and things. You created a peaceful, serene, moonlit reservoir at night. And although it's not a perfectly authentic pitch black moon, because we won't see anything, it actually has the atmosphere of a moonlit reservoir and light on the water. And in that sense, it's actually a nocturne, because it creates a nocturnal a mood and an atmosphere of the night that's not actually of night, but of the night. So that's what we do that for. And I'm not going to change that, because I think that it does create a very, very wonderful atmosphere, particularly when you've got this beautiful Lancaster flying through it, which is the most beautiful aircraft in the world, bar none, to me. And that's it, really. This is, you can see how, you know, if you care to cast the camera around and zoom in and out, Helen, you can see, you know, where we're going to and how the piece is going to end up. This is the most distant Lancaster, and I'm very, very pleased with that. It's not side on. The light looks lovely from every angle, except for some reason, she just sort of side on doesn't really do it for me. But she does have the most wonderful shape and that lovely pugnacious nose. So that's the thing that now that you've got this beautiful, peaceful, serene valley into which this pugnacious looking, so ugly she's beautiful, or she's beautiful in an ugly way. I don't know which. It's like the French say, jolie lay. She creates this wonderful sort of anti-atmosphere to this atmosphere. And that's why I love the link. And I love the story. To be able to fly it into this kind of environment, right down to low level. By the way, if you think that, some people might say, well, he's got those a bit close to the water. Well, actually, if you think there's a little guy in there and a guy there, and there's a little guy in there and a guy there, and there's crew in there, right? 60 feet is 20 yards. 20 yards is 20 paces. So Ken Brown was right when he said you only have to dip the wing at 60 feet and it'll be on the ground. So that's what you have to think of. There to there, that's about the surface of the water. If you run a line across from there, that's 60 feet from there to there. 52 feet of that was the wing. So if you tilt that over, you've got about another 10 feet to go. So there's your 60 feet. It was a remarkable raid. It's a uniquely British raid. A lot of Americans would say, oh, damn, not another damn Buster's piece. But really, there's always a story not yet told in this piece. I really avoided painting it for a long, long time because of the amount of work that had gone before. And really what I was really saying was, well, I haven't come up with anything original of my own yet that I can state about this operation. But now, having sort of gone down the line a bit and had a few deep thoughts, I came up with Hopgood's Courageous Run. And I've come up with this, and it's just been a wonderful experience to be able to do it. There'll be other pieces, you know. That mean the water thing is my trademark. That's my always a feature of my paintings. I can paint landscapes, but I love painting water. There's very few of us are actually any good at it, and I like to think that I don't make a bad fist of it. So there it is. just to recap it all, this is all building up atmosphere. And what I love doing about water like this is you start building this mist. This mist actually did start to build as the evening or the night wore on. And as I said earlier on before, at the Sorpa Dam was actually quite enveloped in fog. So that will be another painting for another day. I'll be definitely doing the Sorpa, and I will be doing the Ada attack on the Ada Dam. But as the Mona Dam was the main attack for 617 Squadron to go for, that was their main target. Of all the dams to knock down, that was the one that they wanted. And it was a massive effort that they put in. In addition to these three Lancasters here, what I'm also devising is that there will be one or at least two more maybe circling, and that will probably be Dave Shannon and Henry Maudsley. I think they arrived at the dam. Somebody will undoubtedly correct me if I'm wrong. But there'll be maybe at least two more Lancasters somewhere in the background need to be circling in the distance, up over here somewhere or up over there, just in that turn. And that will be it. But there you are, you've got the basic theme of the piece. Just one little technical note. How do you paint light? You see like these things here, the lights on the thing. Well, it was a mixture of white and a mixture of, it's my titanium white, and it is cadmium yellow. Cad yellow is a very powerful staining yellow, and it allows me to do all kinds of marvellous things like flak and things like this. But you know, then I've just been added to, when it's gone a little bit tacky drying like that, I've just added this stuff. This is Naples yellow, that stuff, which then I just dry brush over that, and it just gives me this nice, very nice little afterlight. And it also adding some lights like this and some glint, it takes this back down again as well. That atmosphere around it is taken back, so it's back to this nocturnal view. Along here, down in here, you see how we've got these colours that make these. They're reflecting down here. and I've got to carry these things across. So my job for next week will be to get these done and then do this, and then see about adding more of these. This is the flat, as I say, this is flackets from the tower, because once the by the time we got to Dingy Young's attack, the Germans really were in full flight. They were blasting everything, and I believe that there were even shots coming from the fields or somewhere from the landscape around the dam, or as well as on the dam itself. So that will be a consideration. So it's aircraft and it's flak bursts in the sky and streams of tracer rounds going. That in itself is an art, because if you do too many of those, it looks ridiculous. It starts to look a bit like you're doing a comic strip thing. So they have to be carefully worked out and understated. You know, it's although I work quick and I work very fast, I do work with as much precision and attention to factual detail as I can, and I do sometimes have to pull myself back a bit and say, oh no, we need to have a think about that again. Okay, it's like this water splash. I mean, you're freezing an instant. This, you know, when you bring this up, you're freezing that whoosh in a, and then click, stop. It's in a moment. So it's everything. You've got to think about things that are moving into and through and out of a microsecond. And but that's about it, really. Helen goes back with the camera tomorrow, so I won't be able to do any more to show you. So, but I've worked to show you, at least get it to a stage that where you can start to appreciate where it's coming to its conclusion and where its finishing line lies. To see it finish, you'll have to wait till it's on the website, and which is www.simonatack.com. And you'll see it there, and you'll see it on Facebook and on Twitter, and available from us online anytime you want one. And that's it, really. It's been a wonderful time painting this, like all my paintings are a wonderful experience to work on. I don't have a favourite. It's like asking me, people ask me that, they say, what's your favourite painting? And I said, well, that's a bit like asking me who my favourite daughter is. I don't have one. They all have their special moments. They all have their special to-doings. And they all bring special memories. And this being the 70th anniversary of the Dam Busters Operation Chastise, it's been a marvellous excuse to not put off doing it and to get stuck in and get among it, and you know, and compete with the very best of aviation out there that's commemorating this. It is I think the brief of all to remember and commemorate what these young lads did. But being an ex-RAF man myself, these are my past brothers and my past family is how I see this. And that's why I paint it. And I'm the only other aviation artist I know, apart from Mike Rondo. He and I are both ex-RAF. And so we paint from the spirit of the service that's in our DNA. And that's all I can really say about it. So thanks for watching. Thanks for bearing with us on the upload times. And maybe one day I shall get the camera back in here and I'll be painting something else, and I'll be rabbiting and waffling and boring you all to death into a coma over that. So thanks again for watching. Thanks for supporting my art. Thank you for buying my art, those of you who've actually bought any, so I can eat now. As you see, I'm starving. So that's it. That's a wrap. That's it. Thank you very much. Mwah. Goodbye.